what I am about to tell you is something that you may find maybe controversial, maybe strange, or even bizarre, because I will be talking about, let's say, logical analysis of one of the theories within a theology. Even that thing may may be considered strange for some people. But I won't be speaking about any theology whatsoever, but about a particular kind of theology, namely the negative theology. It's very peculiar kind of theology. On the popular level, people say that the negative or apophatic theology is a theory that claims that you cannot say anything about God positively. You can just say something about him just in the negative terms. Thank you. Okay, here I'm showing some definitions. Just two of them, but I could provide many, many more. I just choose mostly by random those two. They were quite short, could fit in, into the slide. Anyway, going into a bit deeper level, negative theology claims that God is so sacred, so transcendent, so to speak, so beyond our scope, that our that we cannot actually say or know anything about him. Our knowledge, our language is so limited. Should I? I think it doesn't work anyway. Does it work? No, it doesn't. Okay. What I was talking about? Definitions. Yeah, so our language is imperfect, our knowledge is imperfect, we have some limitation, and God is... To nie działa. Raz, raz. Does it work? Can anybody hear me? Can... Okay, thank you. And again, okay. Maybe I switch the slide and I will see. Okay, why is it hard to... Why I thought that you may find it strange? Because negative theology is one of the most vague, most unclear, most mystical theory of God ever made. It's very... at first glance, it's inconsistent. But first, this is those are words of Jan Woleński, who will give a talk later today. He says that logic, I mean, his main point is that logic can be applied to theology, just as it is for in the case of philosophy. But in the case of negative or apophatic theology, logic plays no essential role. And this is very hard to disagree with him. Why? I took this example, it's fair to say that I took this example from Paweł Rojek. Here is the passage from Pseudo-Dionysius, the Areopagite, and he violates here, I think, at least two basic principles of logic, namely the law of identity and the law of excluded third. Some of you may be happy about it. Anyway, and me too, I find the negative theology very resistant to formal analysis, But anyway, there were some attempts to grasp it in a formal way, or I would rather say semi-formal way, and to analyze it in that fashion. And I will be talking about those attempts. But firstly, I have to say that, in my opinion, we can divide. There are many interpretations of negative theology, and we can divide it into four groups. The first group I call the theology of science. This is a theory of unspeakable, unexpressible, and ineffable God. It's the linguistic component is stressed out here. The second group of interpretations, I call it theological skepticism, because it's a theory of unknowable God. There is also very interesting interpretation named by its author, positive negative theology. So you can see it's a serious topic by the name. And also the interpretation that stress out its origins, namely the Neoplatonic philosophy. In my talk, I'll focus just on the first group of the interpretations, and I'll show you just three examples of such attempts to save negative theology from inconsistency, and I try to show that all those attempts result as a failure. So theory of unspeakable is one of the most popular interpretations. It originates from the fact that for the most apophatic theologians, denials as well as assertions are the inappropriate way of speaking of God. It's also very common among, let's say, philosophers of religion, such as Rudolf Otto, Karl Barth, and Karl Rahner. For example, the latter has this theory of this holy order, this ganz andere, and he says that God is, you know, numinous, and the reaction to God is this mysterium tremendum and mysterium fascinans, and so on. But at the result, the proper reaction to encounter such as mystery is just to remain silent. And this interpretation is often associated with the works of Pseudo-Dionysius in modern interpretation of negative theology. Is it anything unclear for up to this moment? Okay. theory of unspeakable is often accused of being inconsistent. It's very easy to show why it is so. This is a passage of Durant. He says that on this account, in saying that God's nature is fundamentally inexpressible, we have already described God's nature, namely that is fundamentally inexpressible. So we contradict ourselves. Okay, but as I told already, there were some people who tried to solve this problem. One of them was Peter Kugler. He analyzed the works of Pseudo-Dionysius, and he claims that the main metaphor underlying apophatic theology is the metaphor of darkness, but it expresses itself in the fact that we cannot ascribe any properties, any predicates to God, and we cannot say anything about him. He proposes what he calls universal principle of negative theology, which is for our properties Q, God neither has nor does not have Q. It's very easy to show that it leads to a contradiction. Consider the property, any property, but for the purpose of this talk, let it be property B of being blue. Now let us formulate more complex property of neither being nor not being blue, and denoted by B star. That we are forced to admit that God has the property B star, while at the same time, according to the principle, universal principle, he should neither has nor not has have B star. So for this reason, he proposed another principle, which he calls ENT, existential principle of negative theology. There is no property Q such that either God has or does not have Q. The reason of introducing this principle with the in this existential form was that the UNT produces as many paradoxes as there are predicates in the language. Okay, but let me first. Okay, when we formulate this this principle in the language of the second order, because you know when you see a formulation like that, the choice of the second order logic seems obvious. So when you formulate it more formally, this paradox is much more apparent, I would say. And one, I think one crucial remark is, I owe you this remark here. In the philosophy of God, or in the analytic philosophy of God, there is a struggle whether the term God is a proper name or a description. And it has far-reaching consequences, because if you would like to admit that God is a proper name, you formalize it as an individual constant, as I did here. But of course, you can formalize it, you can stand in a position that God is a description, and in that case, you would formalize it utilizing a predicate, let's say GX, which means G is God, G is God-like, divine, or so on. The thing is, when you formalize God as an individual constant, you have to admit that he exists, because that follows from the rules of first and second order logic as well. But I did it in the former manner. I mean, in my example, God here is an individual constant. And I did it for a reason, but I won't go into a detail here. Here is the formalization of this ENT that Kugler proposes. And as I said, the reason for introducing this principle in the with the existential quantifier was that the UNT produces as many paradoxes as there are predicates in the language. There is, however, one predicate in the language that leads to a paradox as well, namely the predicate expresses by ENT itself. And Kugler is aware of that fact, and he's trying to avoid this paradox by excluding the property G star from the range of ENT. It isn't fair, you would say, just like, yeah. You would say it's an ad hoc solution, of course. Similar objection one can have to the attempts made by Gell-Mann. He also analyzes the works of Pseudo-Dionysius, and his goal is to provide such framework in which when we negate a predicate, when denials doesn't, maybe negation doesn't follow from denials of a predicate, okay? First, he defines what he calls sortal range. Sortal range of a predicate Q is the domain of objects of which Q or not Q can be significantly predicated. And then he provides what I call semantic principle of negative theology, that God is not the sortal range of any of the predicates of our language. Okay. Formalization, or maybe putting it more formal, can be a bit tricky because it has this semantic component. But let me first say that on the syntactic level, it will be one of the form of the Kugler's principles. I think it will be UNT. So all the objections I raised to the UNT will be still in question here. Will be still the question here. Another thing is that if you want to avoid some additional difficulties. You cannot formalize God as a predicate G, X, because God is would be outside the sort of range of the predicate G, which would be contradictory, you know, at the first glance. Anyway, to show that this attempt also ends in paradoxes and contradictions, I use some standard semantics here. So M is an interpretation of the language, U is universal, delta is a function over the individual constants. So here's the standard semantics. Let me just stress that for any in the definition of the interpretation, for any individual constant A, delta A belongs to the universal. Okay. So let delta B be the sets of objects that have a property B. Obviously, delta B is a subset of U, and delta not B is the complement of the delta B, which is U minus delta B. So you can formulate this definition of sorter range in that manner, at least if you are at the level of classical logic. And then we can reformulate SNT in this fashion, that delta G, and G is a individual constant that stands for God here, doesn't belong to the sorter range of B, which is the sum of delta B and its complement, which is the universum. So delta G doesn't belong to the universum, which contradicts the definition of the interpretation. Okay? How many time do I have? Up to 15. Okay. That's good, because I'm about to... The last example I would like to show you is a proposition of Jonathan Jacobs. First, let me say that he distinguishes between fundamental truths and, let's say, derivative truths, like not normal truths. So he introduces an operator, which I write as a box here. So box A is read as fundamentally A, or even A curves nature at its joints. It's taken from Plato. Okay, so I know it sounds bizarre. Unfortunately, he's not very specific about how this operator works within the system. Okay, he doesn't provide an axiomatics for this operator. So, you know, we don't know what to think about it. But we can, when you read this paper, you can say that for Jacobs, negation is not distributed over the box. Okay, and the operator is factive, which means that from fundamentally A follows A. Fundamental truths, you can write it as a box A, and derivative truths as A, and it is not the case that box A, that fundamentally A. And his principle of apophatic theology would be let G be the set of all true propositions about how the God is in his nature, intrinsically, then for all such proposition, it is not the case that fundamentally A, that this true is a fundamental one. As well, it is not the case that it is fundamentally that not A. Okay, so there is no fundamental truth truths about how God is in his nature. We cannot, we can say something about God, but all this, what we say, given that it's true, of course, is just a derivative truth, okay? That's his concept. Which leads to the claim that we cannot say anything, at least anything fundamental about God. And Jacobs expresses it using the metaphor of theology room. He says that in the ineffability thesis, which I wrote as FNT, if it's true, and we enter the theology room, in the theology room we are allowed to say only fundamental truths, okay? That's the case. We can do nothing but remain silent. We could say nothing whatsoever. If we wish to describe God in any way, as loving, merciful, long-suffering, and so on, we would have to leave the theology room. But the thing is that according to Jacobs, God is ineffable by in his nature. He's he is unspeakable intrinsically. So the FNT itself is as well the fundamental truth. So using his metaphor to enter the theology room, we actually would have to stay outside or just stop at the doorstep and do nothing because we cannot enter it. Okay, so that's all what I prepared for today. Thank you. I hope you find it interesting. And if you have any question, you can ask it them either in English or in Polish.